Welcome to nonstopneuron.com, where learning medical concepts is as easy as watching cartoons. In the previous two videos, we talked about the mechanisms of sodium and chloride transport in different parts of the renal tubule. Now in this video, we will discuss the factors affecting this reabsorption. But first, please note that all these factors actually target sodium only. Then the chloride simply follows sodium to balance the electrical charge. Nothing extra is done for the regulation of chloride. So in the entire video, I will mention sodium only. But please remember that chloride absorption is also being affected parallelly. Now coming to the factors. Here first we have glomerulotubular balance. Then we have a set of factors involved in the regulation of extracellular fluid volume. And in the end, we have a few miscellaneous factors. Now let's get into the details of each one of them one by one. First, we have glomerulotubular balance. In a previous video in the series, we saw how various factors affect the glomerular filtration rate, or GFR for short. These changes in GFR can cause undesired changes in the reabsorption of various solutes, including sodium. For example, too much increase in GFR tends to increase sodium excretion. If the body wants to conserve the sodium, this can cause a problem. On the other hand, too much fall in GFR can cause a decrease in excretion. And this can be problematic if the body wants to excrete more sodium. The glomerulotubular balance is a defense mechanism against this type of undesired effects. It is basically a response of the renal tubule to nullify the effects of changing GFR. That is, if the GFR increases, the reabsorption also increases. This helps prevent excessive loss of water and solutes in urine. On the other hand, if the filtration decreases, the reabsorption also decreases. Without this decrease in reabsorption, the kidneys will not be able to excrete enough volume of urine. In short, when there is an undesired change in GFR, the glomerulotubular balance decreases its impact on the final excretion of various substances. This happens mostly at the proximal tubule. Now let's see the exact mechanism behind it. We will see how increased sodium load increases sodium reabsorption. There are two mechanisms involved in this. The first mechanism increases the movement of sodium from the lumen into the interstitium. It is called the luminal factor. And the other mechanism increases its movement from the interstitium into the peritubular capillary. This is called the peritubular factor. Here the mechanism behind the first step is very simple. We saw in the video in reabsorption of sodium that in the proximal tubule, sodium is reabsorbed by various cotransporters and countertransporters. Now, we have so many of these cotransporters that normally, not all the transporters are active. They are like reserved for extra loads. If the load increases due to increased GFR, these reserved transporters also start working. So the reabsorption increases. This was the luminal factor. Now let's talk about the peritubular factor. That is, an increase in uptake from the interstitium into the peritubular capillary. This one is a bit tricky. So let me first clear some basics related to this. First, sodium is filtered at the glomerulus. Some of it moves from the lumen into the interstitium. And the remaining moves ahead in the tubule. From the interstitium, some sodium enters into the peritubular capillary. This movement is driven by Starling forces at the peritubular capillary. It includes colloid osmotic pressure and hydrostatic pressure in the capillary. And colloid osmotic pressure and hydrostatic pressure in the interstitium. Normally, the net driving force of about 20 millimeters of mercury causes this reabsorption. From interstitium, some sodium leaks back into the tubular lumen as well. Now, the peritubular factor, for which we have done this entire setup, basically works on this part. An increase in GFR increases the proportion of sodium uptake in the peritubular capillary. So the back leak decreases. This results in a net increase in the reabsorption. Now let's see how exactly this increase occurs. First, this happens only when changes in GFR are due to changes in efferent arteriolar resistance. We know that increased efferent arteriolar resistance increases hydrostatic pressure in glomerular capillary, and thereby increases GFR. This increased GFR increases the sodium load in the tubule. This tends to increase sodium excretion. But look what happens parallel to this. Increased efferent arteriolar resistance decreases renal blood flow also. This produces two effects. First, due to reduced blood flow, less fluid comes into the peritubular capillary now. So hydrostatic pressure over here falls below 20 millimeters of mercury. Second, an increase in GFR and a decrease in renal blood flow increases the filtration fraction. If you don't remember, filtration fraction, in simple words, is how much of the incoming plasma is filtered at the glomerulus. With a higher filtration fraction, proteins get more concentrated in the glomerulus. So the colloid osmotic pressure in capillary rises. These two changes increase net driving pressure above 20 millimeters of mercury. So more sodium enters into the capillary and less leaks back into the tubule. Thus the effect of increased GFR on final excretion is counteracted. Remember, this mechanism works only with efferent arteriolar resistance. It does not work for changes in afferent arteriolar resistance. It is because the filtration fraction is not affected in this case. So net driving force is also not affected much. So this was glomerulotubular balance. Now let's see the effect of factors involved in control of extracellular fluid volume. You might be wondering, we are studying the reabsorption of sodium, then why do we have ECF volume here? Well, the thing is, the total sodium content of the body is the main factor regulating ECF volume. So the factors involved in regulating ECF volume do their job by regulating the sodium content of the body. And for that, they mainly regulate the sodium reabsorption in the renal tubule. Thus, in simple words, we have a set of factors that come to the renal tubule to regulate sodium reabsorption to eventually regulate the ECF volume. If you still have confusion regarding the whole concept, don't worry. It will be clear in the dedicated video on the regulation of ECF volume. For now, we will focus only on the effect of sodium reabsorption. So, the factors we have here are the renin-angiotensin-aldosterone system, sympathetic activity, vasopressin, and atrial natriuretic peptide. Here the first three mechanisms tend to increase the sodium reabsorption, and the last one tends to decrease it. Let's see the renin-angiotensin-aldosterone system first. The last component of this system, aldosterone, has a direct effect on sodium reabsorption. It mainly acts on principal cells in the distal tubule and collecting duct. Here the transport proteins involved in sodium reabsorption are the epithelial sodium channels at the luminal membrane and the sodium-potassium ATPase pumps at the basolateral membrane. Apart from being present on the cell membrane, they are also stored on the membrane of cytosolic vesicles. Now, when aldosterone comes into the cell, it binds to its receptor. Then the entire complex goes inside the nucleus. Then after a series of transcription and translation, more sodium-potassium ATPase pumps, epithelial sodium channels, and some other proteins are synthesized. Collectively, they all are called aldosterone-induced proteins. The other aldosterone-induced proteins increase the expression of these transport proteins on the cell membrane and also increase their activity. They also increase ATP synthesis in mitochondria, which is required for the activity of sodium-potassium ATPase pumps. In short, aldosterone increases the number and activity of all the transport proteins involved in the reabsorption. So the net result is increased reabsorption of sodium. So this is the main effect of aldosterone. Some effect is also seen in the distal tubule, where it increases the abundance of sodium chloride symporter, and thereby increases sodium and chloride reabsorption. So this was the effect of the renin-angiotensin-aldosterone system. Now effect of sympathetic activity. It reduces sodium excretion by hemodynamic as well as by direct effect. The hemodynamic effect is a reduction in renal blood flow, which reduces GFR and therefore sodium load. Direct effect is seen in the proximal tubule. Here, activation of the alpha-adrenergic receptor stimulates the apical sodium hydrogen exchanger and basolateral sodium potassium ATPase pump. So the reabsorption increases. This was the effect of sympathetic activity. Now effect of vasopressin or antidiuretic hormone. The effects of this hormone are seen at the thick ascending limb and collecting duct. It acts via the V2 receptor, located on the basolateral membrane. In thick ascending limb, it stimulates apical sodium, potassium, 2-chloride cotransporter, and potassium channels. And at the collecting duct, it increases the number of open sodium channels at the apical membrane. And as you can guess by now, this increases the sodium reabsorption. So that completes vasopressin also. The next factor is atrial natriuretic peptide. In contrast to the previous three factors, this one increases sodium excretion. It does so mainly by hemodynamic effect. It causes renal vasodilatation. This in turn increases GFR, and thereby increases sodium in the tubule. It also inhibits sodium reabsorption from the late portion of the collecting duct, by some unknown mechanism. The net result is increased sodium excretion. So these were the mechanisms involved in the regulation of ECF volume. Now some miscellaneous factors affecting sodium reabsorption. First, dopamine. It increases sodium excretion by hemodynamic as well as direct effect. It causes vasodilatation of renal vessels. It increases GFR, increasing sodium load. Besides, in the proximal tubule and thick ascending limb, it inhibits sodium hydrogen exchanger and sodium hydrogen ATPase by effect on D1 and D2 receptors. Thus, dopamine increases sodium excretion. Finally, prostaglandins. PGE2 inhibits apical potassium channels in thick ascending limb. In the cortical collecting duct, it inhibits the activity of the epithelial sodium channel. So there is an increase in sodium excretion. So these are the factors affecting sodium reabsorption. Now let's have a quick summary. Glomerulotubular balance counteracts the effects of undesired changes in GFR on the final excretion of substances. Here we have a luminal factor and a peritubular factor. Then we have factors that modulate the sodium reabsorption to eventually regulate ECF volume. Here we have the renin-angiotensin-aldosterone system, sympathetic activity, vasopressin, and atrial natriuretic peptide. Some of the miscellaneous factors are dopamine and prostaglandin E2. Before we finish, here is a bonus point for you for watching the video till the end. It's about the importance of glomerulotubular balance. These meters show the sodium load at respective locations in the renal tubule. At the very beginning, the sodium load fluctuates so much due to highly varying GFR. However, the glomerulotubular balance adjusts the rate of absorption in the proximal tubule based on how much sodium is coming in. It balances out the fluctuations for the later portion. So the later portion gets a relatively constant amount of sodium. Then the factors controlling ECF volume can comfortably do a precise regulation of sodium reabsorption as per the body's need. Without the glomerulotubular balance, the fluctuation in the later portion would be so much that these factors won't be able to do their job effectively. That's it for this video. If you liked the video, please share it with your friends and colleagues. And don't forget to subscribe because lots more to come. Thanks for watching. See you in the next video.